Today we have Joerg, what he's going to talk about this topic that I dislike very much. I like axion called dark matter, but they introduced this new term that is WISPies. But he will extend axions to any other thing that behaves like that, so there is light particles. Joerg is an expert in this field, has been working for several years, very knowledgeable on the topic, and he's been Heidelberg, DC, Durham, and back to Heidelberg, and he's in heading this field, both in the on the theory side, but also on proposing different potential experiments that could detect these light particles. So he's violating a rule that the talk should be on the whiteboard or blackboard. We will insist that our plan is to stop you as much as possible, yes, because the idea is that you will learn and not just that you show your capability.
Great, so thank you very much. First of all, my apologies for bringing winter to Valencia, apparently. So I was already told that this is very unusual. Despite the announcement, I will actually talk a lot about axions and axion-like particles. The idea is basically that similar techniques can actually be used for a wide variety of other particles. And these are the so-called weakly interacting, and now you can take your pick, slim or sub-electron volt particles. So that's what this WISP is standing for. And today I'd like to focus that even very, very light particles can make good dark matter candidates and good potential dark matter. So, that's a very simple message. We have very little clue what's going on. I think the point is, I don't need to convince you that we need physics beyond the standard model. This you can simply see from looking at the inventory of the universe. It's basically that we know nothing about this, nothing about this, a little bit about this, but actually not all. Just as a side remark, we may understand ordinary matter very well in terms of the standard model, and that's basically all the standard model particles, what is termed ordinary matter here, but we actually have no clue where it comes from. There should be none of that around in the universe. So even these 5% that we seemingly understand, we don't really. But I'll focus mostly on those 27%, which perhaps are the easier part of those things that we don't understand, but maybe not. So one thing we have to ask ourselves when looking for new physics beyond the standard model is, why haven't we found it already? Because it's certainly not for a lack of trying. We have really tried to find physics beyond the standard model, and we haven't found it yet. So we have to really think, why haven't we seen it? And in principle, there are two options, and one is the kind of commonly followed route. Basically, we could say we haven't seen the new particles because they are incredibly heavy. So as we go up in mass for the particles, it becomes harder and harder to produce them in our terrestrial experiments, and if we don't have enough energy to produce a particle, then we can't see it. That's pretty obvious. And the route for exploration in this direction is also pretty clear. We build a bigger machine, and that's what we've done. We've built, for example, just very recently, the LHC, which will start again this year. And that's a well-traveled route, in a sense, and it's a very successful route that we have explored over the years. But very fundamentally, there's a completely orthogonal direction that you can go. It could also, perhaps actually even simpler, be that the new particles are very, very weakly coupled to all our ordinary matter, and we can only do experiments with ordinary matter. So if there is very, very weak coupling between, electrons, protons, and whatever to our new stuff, then it's very hard to find. And in this direction, we need completely different techniques. We need highly precise or highly sensitive experiments, perhaps enormous intensities. And that is, in a sense, for experiments, also a very interesting direction to explore. In a sense, we've also had positive experience in this direction in the past. For example, you could say that neutrino is a prototype of a very weakly interacting light particle. So in that sense, there is also precedent for finding new particles in this direction. And they are actually sub-electron volt particles. So in that sense, if you really want to stretch yourself, you could go and say a neutrino is a very general WISP. The thing, of course, now is there are two extreme directions. We go, let's say, with ordinary strength couplings to higher masses, or we could go in the completely orthogonal direction. We go for very, very light particles, and we go to very, very weak couplings. And here the reason is, of course, well, it's easiest at small masses, so we have a chance to probe very deep to very weak couplings. The really evil directions, of course, are those diagonal directions when it gets very heavy and very weakly coupled. We can make some attempts in these directions, but it's not easy. So that's really the evil direction. If the new physics is somewhere down here, we will have a hard time. So in a sense, we have some known region. We have actually probably, to some degree, more models in this direction, like supersymmetry or extra-dimensional models. We start to have a clue over here. So maybe unknowns is a little bit too harsh. We have candidates, and I'll come to one later. But it's something that has not been quite as intensely explored over the last 40 years or so as this direction. So in that sense, there's a lot more exciting things still to find, at least one may hope. Okay. But the main idea for today is, can these very light and very, very weakly interacting particles be dark matter? And there are some prejudices out there. But let's start with the easier one. Dark matter, what's the main property of dark matter? Well, it's dark. And that we can very easily realize, because if we have very, very weak interactions with ordinary matter, that includes very weak interactions with light, in particular with photons, so it's automatically dark. So anything that's basically not interacting with ordinary matter is automatically dark. So there we are already fine. So in a sense, if we go down here in the coupling region, we automatically have dark particles, and in that sense, dark matter candidates. However, there is a common prejudice around. And this prejudice is that dark matter has to be heavy. Typically, there are masses quoted around kilo electron volt. And I want to talk about sub-electron volt particles, so that seems to be immediately in conflict. But this prejudice is based on one of two assumptions. If you produce particles thermally, then you have a fixed time in the evolution of the universe at which these particles are produced, and basically they have a kind of fixed velocity or energy at that point. And, well, then you stretch them and you redshift them, but if the particles are too light, you can't redshift them enough. So today, they have a rather high velocity, and that inhibits structure formation, because very simply you can think, if a particle is faster than the escape velocity of the galaxy, well, it cannot form a galaxy because it just goes through. So it doesn't clump. Fast particles do not clump. But for this, you really need thermal production. The other option that really requires you to have rather large masses is if the particle is a fermion, because then again you get a minimal velocity, which is basically the Fermi pressure, Fermi velocity, and again, you inhibit structure formation. But that actually tells you just what you need to avoid this prejudice, in a sense. What you need is you need a non-thermally produced particle, and I'll come back to that in a second. will use the so-called misalignment mechanism, and it needs to be a boson. It can't be a fermion. And that is exactly what an axion, or an axion-like particle, or also a hidden photon, is. So you need non-thermally produced bosons, and then all these prejudices about the mass are gone.
Do you need two of these conditions, or one of
them? These two you need both.
Both.
Because either one of those is fatal. Because thermal production, you have minimal velocity, and with fermions, you never can go below the minimal velocity. So in that case, you really need both. You need non-thermal production, and you need bosons. But axions, axion-like particles, exactly fit those bill. So there is a myth around, and I think at least for now, we can already declare it to be busted.
This would imply that you don't, for instance, light neutrinos that are not thermally produced, because they are very, why is that excluded?
Because if they are too light, you want to have a certain density in the galaxy, for example, let's say 300 MeV per cubic centimeter, and you can calculate the Fermi velocity, basically from the Pauli principle. You cannot have all neutrinos.
You are saying that large scale structure,
basically galaxies wouldn't form,
okay.
Because simply the Fermi pressure is too big. So, yeah, it's around killer electron volt. You can go in both directions a little bit.
But there's a simple basic assumption you're doing is there is only one component for dark matter. That's what you're doing. Or this is the main component.
Yeah, for the main component.
Yeah.
Let's say if you have a reasonable number of dominating components, it still applies within a factor of a few. So it's not you can't really go and avoid this limit by having three types of fermions. If you had 3 million types of fermions, you can probably go a little bit beyond. But that may be an interesting theoretical thing, but I'm not convinced, let's say, at least for it. You need a good reason, let me put it like this. Okay. So let me come to the kind of really the prototype of a WISP. And it's one that has been around for quite a while, and that is the so-called axion. It just is really the kind of best motivated and most well-known example for such a particle. Where does it come from? And that's basically the motivation for introducing the axion. To see that, let me take a brief detour to QCD. So that's a simplified version of the QCD Lagrangian. Here you have the gauge field kinetic term. Here you have the quark kinetic terms, and you have some mass terms for the quark. And the yellow parts are those that are usually shown if you hear a talk about QCD, or if you look into a textbook about QCD. But in principle, there is this red part, which again is made up from the field strengths, and it's field strength dual, and it comes with its own dimensionless parameter. And if you want to think about in a very simple way, if you think about this field strength in terms of electromagnetic field strength, in a sense, this is nothing but a coupling E dot B. So it's electric field times magnetic field. And the important bit is it has its own dimensionless parameter, which, if you don't know anything about it, you would guess it to be of order one. So it should be an order one dimensionless parameter. Now, the interesting bit about this red bit is it violates CP, or if you want, time reversal. And the time reversal is to some degree easier to see. It's a time reversal violation that is connected to the strong interactions. So you can ask yourself, where would I find it? Does it have observable consequences? So I have to look for a time reversal violating quantity in a particle that is connected to the strong interactions. And a particle that is connected to the strong interactions is a hadron, and a suitable hadron, simply because it's easier to measure, is the neutron. And the reason it's easier to measure is electric dipole moments have something to do with electricity, so you want to apply electric fields, and a proton would simply, you know, zoom away in an electric field. So you want a neutral particle that is not overshadowed by basically the monopole charge or the electric charge. So you go ahead and look for the electric dipole moment of the neutron. You can quickly convince yourself that it indeed violates time reversal. And the idea is very simple. A dipole moment simply means, roughly speaking, that you have a positive side of the neutron and a negative side, so you have a direction for your charge. And this direction has to be somehow aligned to the spin of the particle in some relation. And now you can think, if I take, for example, spin like this, and dipole moment like this, then I apply time reversal. Well, the charge configuration doesn't change, but the direction of rotation, of course, changes. So the spin goes in the opposite direction, so you have an oppositely aligned dipole moment and spin, and that would correspond to a new state, and we haven't found it. So any electric dipole moment would violate time reversal invariance. Now, people have looked for it, and they haven't found it. So basically, they've looked actually to an amazing precision. They've looked for a dipole moment of the order of 10 to the minus 28 electron charges times centimeters, and that's something like 10 to the minus 13 electron charges times centimeter. And then you can, not centimeter, times Fermi. And then you can quickly think, a Fermi is roughly the size of the neutron, so that's seemingly a natural size. An electron charge, well, your quarks have order one charges, so electron charge times Fermi sounds like a good starting point for your dipole moment. You can add a few kind of loop factors or whatever you want to throw in, a few 4 pi's, but that gives you, say, a reasonable 10 to the minus 3. So your dipole moments should be of the order of 10 to the minus 3 electron charge times Fermi, but you find less than 10 to the minus 13. So something is odd here, and that odd thing is that, of course, it has to be proportional to this CP violating parameter, and if that's not order 1, but it needs to be now of order 10 to the minus 10, and that's something really weird. It should be of order 1, there's no good reason why it shouldn't be, and you find it to be less than 10 to the minus 10. So you want to kind of get rid of it, and that's the so-called strong CP problem, and that's what the axion is going to solve.
So one question here, yeah? Very simple, just so from someone's non-expert may get the... So you are connecting something that you observe, that this is the electric dipole, yeah, in a description that only discusses strong interactions.
Yeah.
So it could be that the way to connect your strong interactions to what you see, that is your electric interactions, your electromagnetism, there is some many more factors there, without getting still into models, right? Because you are just connecting two sectors that look very different, right? One is strong interactions, that term is pure strong interactions.
Yeah.
And this is something how these particles that, of course, are interacting at the quark level with strong interactions, but you are mentioning dipole interactions, that means the electromagnetic. So that means there is a jump there, that is some kind of maybe a loophole in this discussion, right?
Yeah, but you can simply do this calculation in a sense, or, well, that is one thing one has to say. So you can do this calculation, but it's not super precise. That is one thing. You can simply plug in if you want, and there is actually a subtlety going along with that. You can plug in this interaction, and then you start your QCD calculation of the hadron. And then you get a number, which is indeed of order 10 to the minus 3 times theta times electron charge times Fermi. So these calculations have been made using different types of models for the hadron. There is some uncertainty. It's really a proper kind of properly dirty QCD calculation. There are a factor of 3 or perhaps even more uncertainties. it's really, in that sense, you could even call it a first principle calculation. So there is no loophole in there. There's an uncertainty of a factor of a few, but no loophole. Technically, just as a side remark, what you actually typically do is you do not plug this theta in here, because the actually measurable quantity is a combination of theta and the argument of the determinant of this mass matrix. And you can shift between the two by chiral transformations. And you use the chiral transformations to actually eliminate that one and make the mass matrix complex. And that is what you then use in your model calculation. But the calculation can be made, so there is no real loophole except for a factor of a few in there. So it's not going to come out zero, if that's what you're worried about.
I wanted to go in that direction. So if you have, by chance, I know that you would like to explain that, but by chance, a cancellation between the theta and the part that comes from the Yukawas, in principle, you could have something very small just by
Bad chance. That is that is absolutely true. It's like you could have a value theta equals zero. It's a fine-tuning problem. Good that you make me stress it. It's not a contradiction in the theory. You could accidentally have a small value, but it's really weird. You should expect order one, and there is nothing really that prevents it being order one. The universe wouldn't be screwed up if theta is 0.1, and the electric dipole moment is much larger, or 10 to the minus 4. At least to my knowledge, or maybe even anyone's knowledge, there is nothing that would really prevent us from existing, for example.
One more question, I'll let you go. So how large is the contribution that comes from the CP term in the Yukawas respect to theta? It's a small number, so that means for people just to compare. So because the observable theta is something that is, the one that you have in this term plus some contribution from the Yukawas, how much is that term?
So the standard model contribution, once you invoke the axion to kill the theta, is about, I think, 3 or 4 orders of magnitude below what you currently measure. So it is quite a bit lower. So there is actually still room to discover other new physics. You also? Okay. So in that sense, you have a problem. But as you made me say more forcefully, it's really a fine-tuning problem. It's not a contradiction in the theory. But you can view it, in a sense, like the Higgs mass. The Higgs mass is also a fine-tuning problem. Why is it smaller than the Planck mass? But in a sense, it sounds a little bit smaller because it's only 1 in 10 to the 10 instead of 1 in 10 to the 32 or something, whatever you want to choose. But at the same time, the universe would be very screwed up if the Higgs mass is much higher, or the electroweak VEF is much higher. Whereas with the theta, the universe would be very much the same as it is now. So in that sense, you can't go and be anthropic here. Not that I want to go this route, but you can't really in that sense. Okay, so how do you solve it? And that's the famous axion solution to this CP problem. And for some reason, it displays all thetas as mu's. So mu's are thetas. My computer crashed on Friday. So that's how it looks now. So what do you do? What you make theta a dynamical degree of freedom. So you basically allow it to take any value it wants to have. And you can quickly check that any value means a value between minus pi and pi, because it's kind of periodic, because this term is actually topological. Anyway, so you give no preferred value. That means your dynamical degree of freedom has a basically flat classical potential. And it's a classical potential. And now the interesting bit is you can now actually calculate or estimate QCD quantum corrections. And the QCD quantum corrections really break this classical flat. and that's basically the axial anomaly. And what it does, it gives a non-trivial potential for this theta parameter, and the funny thing is it turns out to have a minimum at theta or theta effective equals zero. That means it has a minimum at the CP conserving value. So in that sense, CP really likes to be conserved in the strong interactions. So what happens now is wherever you start at some initial value, well, as the field evolves, you somehow end up at the CP conserving value. That means basically the strong interactions really do not like to violate CP. For that, of course, we must allow it to be a dynamical degree of freedom. So that's the one thing we have to put in. And we have to give it no initially preferred value. So no classical potential. Then, and that seems like a trivial consequence, if you're sitting here, it can still move around. And that, of course, gives you a new particle, and that's the axion. It seems like a trivial observation, but for some people, annoyingly, probably, if it's found, Petrie and Quinn didn't make this observation. That was done by Weinberg and Vilcek. So they invented the whole mechanism, and they didn't predict the particle. So they could really be angry at themselves once it's discovered. Anyway, okay. Technically, you arrange this classical flatness by introducing a U1 symmetry.
Sorry, so they invented the mechanism and they introduced a field and they didn't talk about the particle associated to that field?
Yeah. You know. But that said, as far as I know the story, Higgs was also pushed into doing that by the referee of his paper. So it's a common oversight, apparently.
Yeah,
not. Yeah, it was solving the strong CP problem. So that was the objective. So they missed, however, the physical consequence. And at that time, kind of this
so
got...
How far apart are these two papers?
Not very. I think it's a few months.
Yeah,
so Weinberg and Vilcek immediately noticed
yeah,
that. It's a... That there is a particle associated with it. And the reason is very simple, because, and that's in a sense what makes it a proper oversight.
Who decided there was a particle?
Weinberg and Vilcek.
Ah, okay.
So Petrie and Quinn invented the mechanism,
okay.
And Weinberg and Vilcek then.
Separate.
Completely separate. And Weinberg and Vilcek are also separate.
Yeah.
Petrie and Quinn published together, and Weinberg and Vilcek didn't. Anyway, the reason. Why it's actually a little bit more surprising, because how you do it technically is you put in a U1 symmetry, you break it spontaneously. You put a global U1 symmetry in and you break it spontaneously. Now, that gives you a Goldstone boson. A Goldstone boson with classically flat potential, basically no potential at all. And that's essentially the axion. And it's only because it's an anomalous symmetry that you get this potential, and that makes it a pseudo-Goldstone boson. So in a sense, it was a known mechanism. But, well, bad luck. Anyway, a very naive argument, only semi-correct, is you can now think classically, you have a flat potential by symmetry. It's basically really the Goldstone mode. And the quantum corrections are kind of small. And that should immediately hint at the possibility that this particle is light. And after all, it's a pseudo-Goldstone boson, so it's the lighter, the higher the symmetry breaking scale actually is. And if you put in nowadays constraints on the symmetry breaking scale, you find it's a weakly interacting, actually sub-electron volt particle. And that's, of course, a good motivation to search for it. But it's also, and I'll come to that in a second, a very nice dark matter candidate. Okay. Main properties of the axion, just in brief. The axion typically acquires its couplings to two gauge bosons, and that can be two gluons. That's basically the initial thing that you put in. But it can also acquire similar couplings to two photons via such a triangle diagram with very heavy particles going around in the loop. There's also an anomalous contribution from the mixing with the pi, and that you can hardly get rid of. So you typically have the axion coupled to two photons. And that's this coupling. It is FF dual for the photon now, the axion field, and a dimensionful coupling constant, because that's a dimension 5 operator that has dimensions 1 over a mass. And you can actually calculate that in an axion model. And it turns out to be proportional to alpha over 2 pi. So that's about 10 to the minus 3 times 1 over the spontaneous symmetry breaking scale. So if the scale of spontaneous symmetry breaking is very, very high, then this coupling is very, very small. And if you go in the other direction, that means if you explore very, very weak couplings, you are actually probing very, very high underlying physics scale. So that's a very nice connection. And by actually even looking for very light particles, you get access to very high fundamental physics scales. Okay. And the mass typically also turns out to be proportional to 1 over F. So that again gives you light particles. Okay. But now let's come to the main topic. It can also be a nice dark matter candidate. And the mechanism is actually, again, very simple. You can easily understand it from the same picture we had before. Now you think just at very, very early times. At very early times, QCD is very weakly coupled. You have basically before the QCD phase transition, you have no potential for the axion, so you have your flat potential. That means there is no preferred region, or no preferred value for your theta parameter. So you can sit anywhere. And it's very unlikely that you sit at the CP conserving value. And now the universe cools down, a potential develops, and then basically your field can start rolling down the potential. And of course, it rolls down and it rolls up again. So it starts oscillating back and forth. And you can quickly check that these oscillations actually behave like a non-relativistic matter. They scale away like 1 over the volume. They dilute like 1 over the volume. So in that sense, they behave exactly like temperature zero non-relativistic particles. And that's exactly what you want for dark matter. You can easily understand the temperature zero property in a very rough manner. What you're assuming is that in the observable universe, and that's at least a simple way to do it, that basically in the observable universe you have the same value everywhere. And that's ensured by inflation at early times, because, well, if you had some wiggles, they are all stretched away and you have in all the observable region just one value for your axion field. So now you have a constant field, a spatially constant field. The momentum operator in quantum mechanics is the spatial derivative. So if you take the derivative of a constant field, it means it has no momentum. So in that sense, it's a particle at rest. And, well, a particle at rest is pretty non-relativistic. So in that sense, we expect it to behave like non-relativistic particles. So now you can do it. And you can now ask yourself, in what kind of parameter regions can this particle be axion dark matter? And you can see that here in this plot. And that is now the mass of the particle. That is the coupling constant. And it's the coupling constant in 1 over GeV, so somewhere over here. That means 10 to the minus 11 inverse GeV. So very roughly speaking, if you use the formula I had on earlier, that corresponds to a spontaneous symmetry breaking scale of about 10 to the 8 GeV. So some really high fundamental physics scale. Okay, Now, the axion really has a prediction for the relation between the mass and the coupling. So axion models live in this hatched band over here. Now, so far so good, you can now simply apply experimental constraints. You can ask yourself, would we have seen these couplings and that, all these so bands here, yeah?
That prediction includes also thermal production of axions?
And no thermal production is included. But here, at these weak couplings, you don't have a significant amount of thermal.
But yeah, but I mean, if you go to higher masses...
If you go to higher masses, roughly, let me put it, roughly around here, you start having significant thermal production, and that is excluded. But this is also mostly excluded by now by direct observation. So simply direct experiments or observations looking for axions. Now, you could think, okay, with my mechanism, I can wonder how much dark matter do I actually get? And the amount of dark matter you get is basically related by how far can I excite this field. Here I've used this dimensionless variable, but if you scale it in proper physical scales, it gives you basically a field range from axion or symmetry breaking scale to symmetry breaking scale, so it's a field range of about 2 symmetry breaking scales, and therefore depending on the symmetry breaking scale you can have bigger or smaller excitations of the axion or axion-like particle field. So in that sense you have a limited field range, and that means a limited amount of dark matter. And the other thing is, of course, if your particle is heavier, you of course in a sense get more. So you have the two parameters, your field range, that means how many particles can I have in a sense, or how much energy can I store, and the mass. And that determines if you can actually get enough dark matter.
Yeah. Yeah, because just to make it clear, up to here what you discuss is how much energy is going to be in the axions, not what is the mass. So
yeah.
This determines how much energy is going to be producing action.
Yeah, so basically this is a cosine potential, so it has a maximum.
Yeah.
And that gives you a maximum amount of energy you can have when you start. And the mass in the end determines when you start rolling down the potential.
And this is assuming that the scale where the symmetry is breaking, the energy scale is after inflation.
No, this is in a sense a scenario when the symmetry breaks before inflation.
Okay.
But that is mainly for simplicity. If it happens afterwards, the point is simply you can't choose your initial field value.
Indeed.
Because then you have random values because you can't homogenize anymore.
Yeah.
I do that only for simplicity. You can have the other situation as well. But you are then very fixed in a sense.
Very fixed
why? Because then within the you don't have a homogenized field value all over the observable universe, but instead you have random wiggles in the universe. And then you basically get an average. And this average is just, well, you wiggle basically any value, but you basically average over all possible field values, and therefore your density is fixed.
Yeah.
You have no choice anymore, because you're simply average, you get a fixed average over the random fluctuations. So you have no freedom anymore. So in that sense, you get a very fixed dark matter density in this scenario. So now you can crank the handle, you can play a little bit with different couplings to visible matter and so on. But essentially, in all this region here, you can get it to be dark matter. It's not always free of fine-tuning, in a sense, because if you want to have a very small amount of dark matter, you need a very small initial density or initial field value. So if you, in certain region, there is some fine-tuning, so you may not really like that, but it's still a possibility. But the most natural regions are, in a sense, souls that lie exactly on the boundary, and that's also the kind of density you'd have if the initial field value is of order 1, or if you average over fluctuation. So in a sense, the most natural regions are souls over here, and that's basically these boundaries. Here you need to play with cosmology.
A very stupid question, probably.
Yeah?
I'm said this looks like a zero temperature particle.
Yeah.
Because the momentum is very small. I mean,
yeah.
Isn't this like a slow roll inflation? I mean, like, why doesn't this inflate in some sense?
So, in a sense, at very early times, you could think if you're sitting over here, it acts like dark energy. But it has a kind of appreciable curvature. It always rolls down relatively quickly. And as soon as you roll, as your field rolls, it's leaving the slow roll regime.
But also this zero temperature thing, I mean, argument at least, I
don't know. No, but homogeneous field doesn't mean, it's not sufficient for inflation. For inflation, you need that the field is homogeneous and basically not moving. But as soon as the field starts moving, it actually behaves more like matter. Indeed, the inflaton field in a lot of potentials, if it kind of falls down and then has some kind of quadratic potential at the end, can behave as matter. It basically creates a matter-dominated phase. So in a sense, the inflaton as well can have both regimes.
But
one is where it's
an inflaton as well?
Yes, but not really an inflaton. That is a bit of a stretch, because usually, at least the axion, you could make some axion-like particles and then all bets are off, and people have done that. For the axion, the energy density is typically quite small. But people have actually used it for dark energy. But it can't really be dark energy and dark matter at the same time. Because for one, you want to basically be non-rolling. And for the other, you want to be quickly rolling, in a sense. So it's basically the slow roll and the fast roll regime of the same field. And for dark matter, you want to be in a kind of fast roll regime. Yeah, but to do that, I would need to switch off the mass. So basically, if I want to make it a dark energy model, I make the mass very, very, very small. For masses of the order of 10 to the minus 33 electron volt, my axion becomes a dark energy candidate, in a sense.
But in any case, if you want to solve the QCD problem, you have to do that, go to somebody.
Yeah.
But one more thing that you explained, but it was not too clear to me. So that means if it is before inflation, if this happens before inflation, it's clear that one theta has been chosen. This
yeah.
is the one that is in our universe. And okay, and then it rolls and that's all this stuff when the QCD phase transition. But if it is after inflation, each spot in the sky or it's a part of the sky will have a different theta. Isn't that
yeah.
right? Or will it start with a different theta?
Yeah.
I don't understand what's the meaning of this averaging. In principle, I could be here, and here there will be some field, and there another field.
You can calculate the regions.
Yeah.
You can calculate the regions that
okay,
have
yeah.
different, so the typical size. It's the horizon time when the QCD acquires its potential.
Yeah.
And you can calculate how big that is.
And how big is that?
And that's not very big. It's big for us. It's kind of solar system sized or something.
Solar system sized.
But it's not big enough to resolve as dark matter, as kind of inhomogeneities. It's like big clumps of dark matter, in a sense, moving around. It can have interesting consequences. And it, in some regions, it's quite unclear if there are possible effects of structure formation. But at first order, I would say it behaves like fairly big lumps, but not resolvable from cosmological observations.
Okay.
It's called axion mini clusters,
yeah.
but mini says it for dark matter scale.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, in this whole region here, you can have dark matter, and I simply left also the axion band. But if I talk about axion-like particles, I allow myself simply complete freedom in the plane of masses and couplings. So that's simply what axion-like particle means. It's coupled like the axion to two photons. But it has an arbitrary mass. It has no fixed relation between mass and coupling. But the axion dark matter would simply be in this yellow region over here.
So you made some little jump here, because here you are saying that the axion gets a mass.
Yeah.
But that was not explained before. Before it was that at the end you have a theta value that goes, so I mean you acquire a particle, but
yeah.
there the mass is still not defined. The mass, for the mass you need some...
No. The mass comes really from the QCD quantum corrections. If you have a non-trivial potential, the non-trivial potential has a curvature that you can calculate from QCD, and that basically fixes your mass. And it's really calculable. Once you have the symmetry breaking scale, it's calculable in QCD with reasonable precision again.
Okay,
so
if then you go to that plot, you
axions live on this band.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, axion dark matter is in this yellow band. There is some uncertainty, fine-tuning, and non-trivial effects, basically, how certain topological defects decay. But roughly speaking, we are here. With axion-like particles, all this kind of shaded area over here can be dark matter. So it's very, very flexible, with different degrees of fine-tuning. As you go down here, you typically have larger fine-tuning. The nice regions are somewhere over here. And over there, you need slightly weird
but
models.
Yeah, I don't even know what I wanted to ask. I mean, well, or maybe later, I mean, because it's related to isopropagator perturbation.
I'll come. I'll comment on that if I
okay,
still...
Okay.
Oh, I'm approaching. Okay, let me... But so now I'm making a slight jump from axions being sub-electron volts to slightly higher masses, axion-like particles. But the main thing is, again, I'm thinking of pseudo-Goldstone bosons coupled to two photons. So a nice question you can ask, have you perhaps already seen it? And now I'm going on to happily speculate. We had last year this all this excitement about a certain 3.5 keV line. What is that? Oops, let me go back. let me go like this. Two satellites basically are looking for X-ray spectra in galaxies and galaxy clusters, and they found a line, and I'll come to the line in a second, but these are X-ray satellites, so it's an X-ray line in the killer electron volt regime. The caveat comes here, that's the situation with experiment, and so all in agreement. And you can see in a second why. That's the spectrum, and every proper theorist sees a clear peak here. There. Even if you subtract the background, let's say it takes some looking at. Okay, but the people have done, a very sophisticated analysis, and they claim they subtracted all the known backgrounds, but that already says everything. There could be unknown backgrounds. Simply, there are plenty of weird ion lines going on in the plasma that could fake this kind of signal. And not all of them are known, so experimental. So nobody has measured all the possible lines. So there is some uncertainty.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, it's fun to speculate.
Someone claimed that the potassium and chlorine or whatever.
Yeah, so there are potentials.
Yeah.
Yeah, anyway. So how do you get a line? So this is just a fun speculation. How do you get a line? Actually, a particle like we've just discussed is not stable, because a boson coupled to two photons actually decays in a two-body decays to photons, and that is of course a line signal, because well, a two-body decay has precise energy. So if you have a particle of mass twice the line energy, that's a candidate for your peak or signal or whatever you want. And now you can simply fit. You have a signal at 3.5 keV, so you need twice the mass, 7.1. And you need a sufficient decay rate, so you adjust the coupling, and then you're sitting just over here, just outside the existing limits, which is not too surprising, because these limits actually come from X-rays. So if you want to have a signal not excluded, it must actually sit just outside. So here you have a nice potential candidate. Of course, you could also scale down the dark matter density from all dark matter to a subdominant part, and then you simply increase the coupling. So you could move on this line, and of course, if it's not all of dark matter, this limit here doesn't apply anymore, and so you go up. And you can check they're all equal or equally bad from the fine-tuning perspective, because you can see this point over here is actually quite far off the, away from this natural region. So this is dark matter that would be quite a bit fine-tuned. But moving along this line, at least it doesn't matter. A subdominant component would be slightly better if you believe this bicep result. Okay. Brief comment about isocurvature. So bicep 2 has measured, or claims to have measured, here again, big disagreement. Probably no, to be honest, because Planck by now has produced dust maps that say probably not. Anyway, so if what they were measuring were true, they have observed tensor modes. And tensor modes allow you to fix the scale of inflation. And bicep 2 found a very high scale of inflation. Now, why is that a potential problem? If you have the phase transition before inflation, that means the axion as a light field is already present during inflation. Now, inflation, in a sense, tends to homogenize your field value from all the wiggles to one value. But if the inflation scale is high, it acts like a temperature. So basically, if you have a Hubble scale that is very high, it behaves essentially like a temperature that is of the order of the Hubble scale. And that means any light field, any field lighter than the Hubble scale, basically has fluctuations of the order, or field fluctuations of the order of the Hubble scale. And now, these field fluctuations, these are basically quantum fluctuations in De Sitter space, they are completely unavoidable. And these field fluctuations are, of course, once it becomes dark matter, are density fluctuations, and they are isocurvature modes, or so-called isocurvature modes. Basically, they are not the same as the ones we observe, and these are very strongly constrained, and that's basically a problem for all models with light fields during inflation. You get large isocurvature modes, and these are basically excluded by Planck and whatever. They're excluded, of course, only if it's all of dark matter or a large part of dark matter. So trick one is, well, it's only a very small component of dark matter. Kind of boring, yeah, not very nice.
So, what is the constraint? I mean, if you want this to be the dark matter, what would be the constraint on the scale of inflation?
About 10, a Hubble scale significantly less than 10 to the 9 GeV.
GeV.
Yeah. And bicep gives 10 to the 13, 14. Depends if you call energy scale or Hubble scale. I'm talking about Hubble scale. If bicep does not have an observation as it looks now, the solution is simple. Choose a low inflation scale. And it doesn't need to be outrageously low, but reasonably low. That's the easiest way out. To be honest, my preferred option. Because by now I don't really believe in bicep anymore. Option two, you can modify the model. There are gravity couplings that reduce isocurvature perturbations. Not really pretty. And the third option, of course, is you simply change the model such that you have spontaneous symmetry breaking after inflation. And then, since you are doing an average, you're not seeing isocurvature modes anymore. And that is, again, the kind of easy picture. And if you take the axion, it has a nice effect, because now you can't fine-tune your initial value, and you basically get a fixed prediction for the spontaneous symmetry breaking scale, and well, if you have the measured inflation scale, you get basically the spontaneous symmetry breaking scale and the mass of the axion. And it's roughly 100 microelectron volts, with some model uncertainty again. But then you really have kind of pinned it down. So if you measure the scale of inflation, you take this after spontaneous symmetry breaking model, then you basically have a nice little window to look for. Okay.
Wait a second. So look at, show that plot. Okay, so before you told us that the mass is, between, let's say, microelectron ball and a little bit larger than millielectron ball, I come to this plot and say, oh, this looks more like above 100 microelectron ball.
Yes.
So is this because there are particular assumptions here beyond that one that says some action larger than cold dark matter? So it means it's something more assumed? Do you understand what I mean? My question is, could I have an action with mass 10 microelectron balls and this could be dark matter?
Yeah.
So that means what is the exclusion of in this yellow
range? This one?
Range? Yeah.
Yeah, that's about 10.
No, this is 100 microelectron volts.
Ah, 10.
Imagine I say, I have an axion with 10 microelectron volts. Are you telling me that this is already excluded by data?
If you believe BICEP, and there are, I would not, with 10 I would be hesitant, because you can tune a little bit on the model parameters, I would say.
So that means there are some assumptions.
But I would weaken this a little bit here, but not more, not much higher than 10, or smaller mass than 10.
So I still
don't
understand. So you
then
say
for those values, the scale of inflation would have to be below 10 to the 8.
Exactly. So you would need a low scale of inflation, because then you want to be in the regime where spontaneous symmetry breaking happens before inflation, such that you can reduce the field value. The problem to fix it really precisely is that it's not entirely clear in the post-inflation scenario how many topological defects you form, and that gives you some uncertainty. So there you have to be, there I wouldn't want to be pinned down to a factor of 2 even, probably not even a factor of 10. That's why I'm a little bit hesitant. In the misalignment, or not, in the kind of pre-inflation scenario, there it's much easier to calculate everything. In the other scenario, there are topological defects that are simply unsure.
And then you have an extra.
And that's simply an open problem. It's not a fundamental problem. It's a calculational problem, but a very, very difficult one.
Yeah, and it has, the calculations in the literature differ by...
by a factor of 10. That's why I'm really hesitating to pin myself down to a number.
But of course, this is if you believe in bisectors. Yeah. Results, right?
So,
I mean, if not, you are happy.
Personally, I don't, so I can happily live
everywhere.
So, I think by now I simply, I'm not convinced anymore. Okay, already said that. But let me come finally to how we actually find them. I'll try to be brief. It's, in a sense, very easy, because you now have axions as dark matter axion-like particles, so you have plenty of them around you, and it's really a lot. Just imagine, roughly around here, we have 300 mega electron volt of dark matter per cubic centimeter. Now you express that in terms of axions, an axion weighing, say, a microelectron volt. So you have 3 times 10 to the 14 axions in each cubic centimeter. So you have plenty of them around. So that's a good thing. And now it's getting very easy, because you know they interact with 2 photons, in particular with an interaction electric field times magnetic field. So you provide a magnetic field, your axion wanders in, interacts with the magnetic field, and out comes a photon. And it's a photon of a very precise energy, because the magnetic field is a static magnetic field, so it doesn't contribute any energy. So all the energy comes from the axion or axion-like particle. So this photon has the same energy as this axion-like particle. And since it's a non-relativistic particle, it's a dark matter particle, basically all its energy is its mass. So you have a very precise photon signal here. Now, of course, the interaction is very weak, so it happens very rarely. So you want to kind of amplify that, and you do that by using a resonator, which resonates exactly at the photon frequency that corresponds to your axion mass. And that amplifies your signal simply because what you actually do is you're driving an oscillator with an oscillating force. And if you hit the resonance frequency, you get a big excitation. So that's what they do. They really take an axion, take a resonator, they put it in a magnetic field, and then out comes a lot of photons, hopefully, and a microelectron volt is roughly radio frequency range. So out come radio frequency photons, and then you get power, and hopefully at some point you will get a nice little peak at a fixed frequency. And the frequency is simply the mass of the axion. So it would be a very, very easy experiment if you know the mass of the axion, because then you choose your resonator, everything works nicely. But of course you don't. So that's where it becomes difficult, because you have to measure, change your resonator a little bit, measure again, and so on. So in that sense, it's very naively an easy experiment, but since you need to repeat it many, many times, you need to be quick in order to go through and appreciate appreciable mass range in a finite time. And that's what makes it difficult, in addition to actually this being a very, very low signal. A first comment, this peak is actually the distribution of velocity or energy in the dark matter. And in the radio frequency range, you could actually resolve it. Once you found the peak, you can nicely resolve it. It's not a difficult experiment at that point. That you can do in a day after discovery. So you don't need to scale up your dark matter experiments by 10 orders of magnitude the day after you have the energy distribution of dark matter. Anyway, okay. People have done that. And that's actually these small fingers here. And they are narrow simply because you have to scan. And there's also simply a range of technology where you can nicely detect radio photons because you really want to detect small power. And that's, of course, the dream come true, because it's a very green slide here, because that's, of course, the solution to all our energy problems, because we are converting axions into electricity. It's really going to replace all power plants because it has enormous output power, 10 to the minus 23 watts. But the important thing is that's actually detectable. So radio frequency detection is amazing. So that's about a photon a second or so, a microwave photon, and those are very wimpy photons. Bottom line, that's detectable.
Is that the band
going
to expand on the x-axis?
Yeah, that's the plan. So ADMX plans to go to higher frequencies here.
But only losing
sensitivity, like it looks there? Basically, ADMX plans to go roughly here, I think. As steady as I can hold my... But they definitely want to go into the axion band, deeply into the axion band. They will start this year, actually, taking data if nothing goes wrong. Great, thanks.
To go down in the plot means that you need to dedicate more time to a specific frequency.
That's a possible ability. At some point it becomes really painful because the power goes down like G squared. So one order of power goes down by two orders of magnitude. So going very deep down, you can measure longer at the same frequency, or of course you can have a detector which has less noise. The problem is these things are noise limited. But that also has a limit, because actually the detectors they are going to use are basically at the quantum limit. So they are quantum noise limited. That's as far as you go.
But not these bounds. These bounds were these are not yet detectors. So these new detectors are much more sensitive.
Yeah. So these are about 3 Kelvin, and they plan to go to 100 microkelvin in noise temperature. But they are also going to higher frequencies. That's also the plan. At some point, of course, the quantum limit is the limit for coherent detection. You could go for a photon counter. But a photon counter at microwave energies, yeah, not a simple thing to do. They have some ideas, but not easy. Okay.
Yes, yes, I think the question goes in the direction, maybe you can answer is, which is more difficult today? This gray band, what you call fingers, yep, going down or going right?
Both is difficult. I think
that
nowadays...
That you said, nowadays what is more difficult?
So, I think nowadays it's no problem to do that.
Yes.
So, putting them into the axion band, and that's in a certain region, basically that's what they will do here.
Yeah, that's what they promise.
So that's the baseline.
And going to higher frequencies, what is difficult?
Really difficult, because going down is like 1/coupling squared. But taking experimental unfortunate things into account, sensitivity in going to higher mass, I think goes down like 1/mass to the 9th power.
Oh.
It's really
so
painful.
You are really in the region of
Kafka. Well, getting to over there is hopeless.
Yeah. With this technique.
Yeah. But getting, let's say, to 100 micro electron volts, that's what people are hoping for. Mm-hmm. But it's really, this is really, you hit all kinds of things. The first thing is your volume gets smaller, like wavelengths cubed or mass cubed. But also, surface to volume goes up. That means you have more losses. The quantum limit grows.
Yeah.
So everything works against you if you want to hire them. They have ideas.
The signal grows.
Yeah, but
this is the only calculating thing. Yeah.
That's quadratic. The others are many powers.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. There are some small efforts, not just at ADMX in Washington or Seattle, but at DESI and Bonn, there are some recycling efforts to simply try and play a little bit with old Hera cavities. And the idea is to put some fingers, little fingers, on the left-hand side. The whole nice thing is it's like a lottery game. And because if you knew the axion mass, it's actually an other undergrad lab experiments to detect axions. You could basically do it with kind of available technology off the shelf if you know the mass. So making tiny little fingers and playing the lottery is possible with very little effort. But it's a lottery. Anyway, but it's also basically to find out what you can do and complement ADMX efforts. Okay, we've already seen the problem is the scanning. Basically, you always get lines. So
I mean, the distortion of the CMB due to this coupling is ridiculously small, I guess, right?
It doesn't work there.
Yeah.
Not in that regime.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there are some limits, but not in that regime.
Yeah.
So problem is the narrowness of these fingers, so you want a broadband search strategy. And that's what we've been thinking a little bit about. A kind of interesting situation is if you put up a magnetic field, the axions or axion-like particle dark matter behaves like a small oscillating electric field. So now you have a small oscillating electric field, and if you now provide a metal or a metal surface, in the metal, electrons start to oscillate because it's an oscillating electric field. And if electrons oscillate, they emit photons. So the idea is, if you have an electric conductor suitably shaped, electrons start to wiggle, things start to emit photons. And if you shape it right, the photons are nicely concentrated. And the right shape is basically spherical, because you can check that the photons are emitted perpendicular to the surface. So if you have a sphere, everything is nicely concentrated in the center. And that has nothing to do with the resonance. It's completely broadband, it happens for every frequency. Downside is, of course, you don't have a resonant. don't have resonant enhancement. But the upside again is, well, you can make it big. You can simply scale up the antenna. So the idea is to have a rather sizable antenna, spherical kind of conductor or reflector, and you put a detector in the center. That's where the radiation is concentrated. And basically that could give you sensitivity here for these axion-like particles, in particular at higher masses. But at least for the axion-like particles, you see also it's very difficult to really get into the dark matter band. It works better for other types of particles. But that's, in a sense, something we are trying right now. Indeed, with people from DESY and Karlsruhe, there is already a nice mirror in Karlsruhe. It's an Auger mirror. It's fairly big. And it's for free. So the idea is now basically to use this mirror and place a detector in front of it. We are actually meeting on Thursday to discuss a little bit more the setup. And we are not going to look for axion-like particles, but for hidden photons, where it's much easier because it's the same, but without a magnetic field.
Yeah.
It's basically a test to see what one can actually do and what are the difficulties. This is really a kind of extremely cheap test setup. I think Babette, who's pictured here, got something like 5,000 euros of leftover funds from a conference, and it's now going to build on that budget. Maybe a little bit more, but not much. Anyway, this is, of course, a fantastic experiment, not just for detecting the thing, but also for the future, because this can even do better than measuring the energy distribution. It can measure 3D velocity distribution, or at least 2D, because emission is perpendicular to the surface only at velocity zero. If you have velocity non-zero, you get a little kick. That means you actually have to, you just put a screen here and you get a nice picture of the of the transversal velocity distribution of the dark matter. This, you could say, is of course far future. I'm already selling here something that we haven't even detected, but it's also non-trivial for the experiment itself because, well, since it's spread out a little bit, that you have to choose not a point-like detector, but something that actually has a non-vanishing area. And we are talking, with the size of mirror we are having here, we are talking several centimeters squared. And that is a non-trivial experimental requirement, because as you make your detector bigger, up goes your noise. So, but that said, once you have your detection, you simply take a quick snapshot also of your distribution in velocities. Anyway, let me come to the near closing words. I've talked all about axion-like particles, but there are many other well-motivated light particles. A very simple and perhaps my favorite candidates are extra U1 gauge bosons. It's basically the same picture, mass over here, coupling over here, and of course tiny couplings down there. Similar experimental constraints and dark matter range. And here are, again, the kind of ADMX type cavity experiments. And the cool thing is, with the kind of mirror experiments that we have here, we can properly go somewhere down here. So here, really, we go into new untested regions that actually can be dark matter. So that's the kind of nice thing. And perhaps even with a test experiment, it's not 100% clear yet, but it's somewhere around here. It's a bit high in mass because simply the competition is so hard here that we're not quite sure if we're going into new ring. But that's, of course, the aim, to really get into new untested regimes. But here it's much easier. One more comment. I've talked endlessly about photon couplings, but light particles could have other couplings as well, and they still could be dark matter. That's, I think, something one perhaps should explore a little bit more. The one thing I've been thinking a little bit about is typical Goldstone bosons or pseudo-Goldstone bosons coupled to matter in a Goldstone boson-like way. And it doesn't even have to have flavor-conserving couplings. You could have flavor-changing couplings like this one over here, like a mu to E coupling. And you would think, and that was my first thought as well, everything with flavor is completely excluded because flavor constraints are pretty good. But that's actually not true. On the level of tiny couplings we are talking about, usually the best experiments are not experiments, but constraints from astrophysics. And these are the things that limit, let me go back a little, basically limit these tiny couplings down here. That is solar physics with some lab experiment attached in that case, but solar physics itself already is basically on the same level. But the nice thing is, as soon as you involve non-trivial flavor like a muon, things are too heavy for astrophysics. So the sun contains a lot of electrons, but no muons, and it has no energy to make muons. So all these astrophysics limits go away. So the limits are actually not that good. So in a sense, you have a wide range of symmetry breaking scales or couplings that are still available to you. And here it's simply the plot for the best constraint. It's mu and E. That is the one thing that actually has appreciable constraints. And you can see it's 1 over 10 to the 9 or so GeV. But everything below that, every larger symmetry breaking.
The future? What are you?
That, the future experiment is the mu to 3E experiment.
Okay.
Which will start in a couple of years and really take data. So they are looking.
This is not astrophysics.
This is nothing is astrophysics here anymore. These are already mu to E plus gamma and so on experiments. Astrophysics is completely gone.
Yeah.
That's the power here.
Yeah.
The usual level of astrophysics for electron couplings, for example, would be here. That would be astrophysics, roughly.
You look into different objects, say GRBs or so?
Yeah, but as far I haven't found anything that has.
No, but I mean, here is the problem is that how can you tell all the flavor?
Exactly.
I mean,
you basically have very little observables.
Yeah.
That so, in supernova you might have a chance. They have, but just barely. They have 30 MeV. That's maybe not enough. Mm. But you also need observables that really crucially influence things.
Yeah.
Not much came to my mind yet, and I simply don't know anything that works from astrophysics. So in a sense that allows you to go back and think, what can I do in the lab? And that's one thing I think is worthwhile for the future. And maybe that's even too pessimistic, because mu to E or mu E couplings are by far the best constraint. If you talk something like E tau, you're somewhere over here.
Yeah.
So everything that's not E or first generation in general, basically no limits. Okay, so let me finish off. Not, severely over time. Okay, I hope I've given you at least some idea that looking for WISPs is fun and basically perhaps also a little bit useful. It's something different than accelerators, but not replacing it, simply looking in a different directions. And a lot of fun searches are going on.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, let's hope we can open a little door here.
Is there someone else that wants to do some question except for those two?
Those three.
What is recent paper on the thing that gamma signal is interpreted as axions?
So in a sense, because you could have an electron coupling. So it works over an electron coupling, and the xenon and so on are in first order not sensitive to electron couplings. But I think xenon and company actually, if they change their analysis and they've done a few things, by now also rule out that option. And I think it was never really that well working with other constraints anyway. So I'm at least doubtful. But I think it's by now it's more or less, yeah.
Can you explain at least briefly how can you use this new to three experiment to look for axions?
In a sense, yeah. There are problems. I'm standing right in front. So this, if you have an interaction, say d mu phi over f mu bar mu e, for example, that looks fairly complicated. The first thing you want to do to understand it is you do partial integration and you use the equations of motion, and then you get something like m mu over f times mu bar e. So Yukawa-like coupling. So now that you have a Yukawa-like coupling, you can have, say, a mu, a phi, and an e. So you can have a decay like that. And that is basically e plus x. That's not mu to 3e, obviously. But what mu to 3e does is they are measuring all electron momenta very precisely. So they can reconstruct potentially decays that have missing energy. That is e plus miss. So that's one option. They can look for missing energy decays.
So has this been before already?
People have looked for them. That's basically
this one over here.
I think that is crystal ball or something like that. The slightly easier one, people are looking for, simply for technical reasons, is if they have an additional photon. And that's the other thing they're at least thinking about in mu to 3e. You could have a small covering of a photon detector as well, some photon conversion target, and then you have a nicer signature. You pay with a little bit of with an alpha suppression, but experimentally that is has a significant advantage. So there they would also need to add a photon detector. But in principle, you're simply looking for missing energy.
Well, I didn't understand the answer to the Pilar's question. So, with respect to gamma, etc. So, I thought that most of these experiments, they separate electron recoils from nuclear recoils, and electron recoils are in the background that they cannot distinguish from other signals. So, probably from extracting. And I guess that here the couplings you are discussing, which ones are? Recoil with electrons or with fermions?
So, and the thing, I think the Dharma explanation was a recoil on electrons. And Dharma is looking for electrons.
Dharma is recoil with electrons?
At least they can see it as well.
Yeah,
and that was that was the kind of, and they always said, oh, we can see electrons, you can't.
Okay,
here we go. But I think it doesn't fit with the rest of the world. That is, and with some tricks, in certain regions, xenon and so on can also look for electron signals. And I think by now that is also in conflict. What they actually do independent of Dharma, which is a very nice thing, is you have this limit from cast here, which is basically axions produced in the sun and then detected with a magnet on Earth. You see that it goes to milli-electron volt masses roughly. But of course, axions coming out of the sun have masses of the order of kilo-electron volt potentially. Cast simply can't see them. But Xenon and so on have done an analysis looking in a sense for things coming from the sun, mm-hmm. which gives them a proper dependence that lies somewhere here. It's still eclipsed by other astrophysical constraints, but it's a very, very good and you could say not purely astrophysical sense because you use the sun but you really make a detection on Earth. In that sense it's a kind of more secure limit here. Because that limit here are some globular cluster stars. Where you might say, personally I wouldn't want to mess with star formation, but there are possibilities.
Yes.
You can construct weird models.
Yeah.
Weird models, of course, also still allow you to avoid these xenon constraints as well.
And that's here a sentence from someone from particle physics. Most astrophysicists will blame on these particle physics bounds, and will say that the ones from astrophysics are really very strong, because you can have stars. You should have more stars or less stars in a given. So
that is personally pretty secure, but you can make really weird particle physics models.
Yeah, that's
for sure. Okay, so I think we can end here. Let's thank.